Hi, this is Randy Lee with Apex Tactical Specialties. This is our tutorial on how to install the forward set sear trigger assembly and components. So to start with, this is the package that you will find in the mail. And I'm going to pull out the individual components because there's several out there that in this kit that you may not have seen before. The first being the trigger. The trigger is hard anodized aluminum and is really at least 50% of the total equation. What we have is a independent center hinged articulating trigger safety, which is spring-loaded and a much smaller profile. On the trigger also is the integral over-travel stops and pre-travel or take-up. So this works in conjunction with the sear. This is the forward set sear. If you can see where the camming surface is, this has been extended forwards. And what this does is it allows the change of the timing radically, so much so to the point where you essentially have a 1911 type of trigger feel, where there's very, very limited pre-travel and very limited over-travel. It's designed such that this is a complete drop-in set that allows you to have the advantages of a very short travel trigger system, but maintains all the safety functions and features inherent in this, the M&P pistols. It also works for both the standard 9mm 40-357 SIGs as well as the full-size and compact models of the 45. There's another package in the back, and this has several other components that are added in the kit. As with all our competition and duty carry kits, we have the Talon Tactical Sight Tool, which is just to hold everything in place, the plunger cap, while you're reinstalling your sights. We also have a modified striker block. The reason we modified it was because we changed the timing so much that our standard ultimate striker block will not work because everything shifted forwards in the trigger stroke. We also have a trigger return spring, which brings the pull up to a nominal 4 pounds. The camming surfaces on the sear are such that it reduces the trigger pull even further or more drastically than our standard duty carry competition kit sears, our standard hard sears. We've got the striker block spring. We also have an additional sear spring. And we recommend, this is the 1/8 inch diameter sear springs. We recommend that you install the larger diameter. If your sear housing block is not designed for this, the earlier generations had a small, about an 069 or 070 diameter hole and a very, very tiny spring. Because of the change in the mass locations, it's really recommended that you find either a sear housing that has the 1/8 inch diameter sear spring and plunger from directly from Smith or one of the other distributors, or contact us at apextactical.com and we can arrange to do the sear modification or the sear housing modification, which allows it to accept the larger spring. This also happens to eliminate the issues of potential dead triggers and sear flutter. The other thing is we also include the aluminum slave pin. In our duty carry videos, we talk about making one. In all our kits now, we've decided to include them in the package. So we'll get started on this installation. The system uses your original trigger bar because that's already been guaranteed to fit and function in your pistol. So the first thing we need to do is remove the slide from the frame. So I'm hitting the sear deactivation lever. See if I can do this right. Moving the slide. Now usually, just like with the rest of the kits, you'll probably need to use a vise to remove the rear sight. To remove the rear sights for the factory ones and most of the aftermarkets, they use a 16th inch hex wrench. In this case, we're lucky enough that the rear sight slides right off. So I can remove this without a problem. Pop out the pre-existing striker block and spring. Insert the forward set Sear specific striker block, and then use the Talon tool just as that third hand to hold the cover plate in place while you slide or tap in your rear sight, depending on how tight it is. That completes the operation for the upper or the slide assembly. The thing I do want to do is make sure and check that the safety features all operate correctly. So pressing on the back of the striker, it's definitely being blocked from its forward travel. To pressing the striker block plunger, the striker should move forwards, and it does. Okay, next thing we need to do, we need to disassemble the frame and get to the sear housing block as well as the trigger group. So I'm using my 1/8 inch roll pin punch and a hammer. And I found typically that the lighter, smaller hammers with light, quick taps tends to work better than trying to use a heavy hammer. Another thing to be concerned about too is that on most of the current guns that have either the ILS or have the frame plugs, be careful not to punch or damage these. They're aluminum with a small surface flange, and those can be damaged pretty easily. Let's remove the front pin. I'm popping out the sear housing block. And then removing the trigger assembly. Okay, as I said, this is your original factory trigger. We're going to use the original trigger pin, the trigger pivot pin, which is located here, and your original trigger bar. Because if you've had work done on the gun prior, we know that this trigger bar in relation to the rest of your gun is functional. So rather than having to redo something, it's easier just to start with this. Also, this is sort of the sacrificial component. As this wears, you can always get a replacement trigger assembly, in which case you can get a brand new one and swap it. Whereas the trigger that we have and manufactured is hard anodized, so it's extremely durable and will probably last the lifetime at least 2 to 3 of the trigger bars. So I'm popping that pin out, separating the sear or the trigger bar. And then here we've got the trigger. Now, one of the things that I'm also going to use, because I'm using the original pin, I'm also using something to pilot the pin into the side. And I definitely, when I'm looking at this, you've got the right side of the trigger and the left side. I'm going to go and punch in straight through the left side because this has the greatest amount of material. And because this is hard anodized, you definitely want to use a drop of oil on the hole just to make sure there's no galling. The next thing I need is something to hold on to the pin while I get it tapped in. This has a pretty good friction fit. We've designed it so that the pin that you pulled out of your original trigger should fit fairly snugly and require a decent amount of force to be able to tap into position. That way it doesn't walk out on you. The next thing I need to do is make sure that I locate the hole for the trigger bar. And if you have a vise, it's a little bit nicer. It makes it a little bit easier because you don't have to try to hold on to 2 or 3 things at the same time. All right. So I'm tapping this into position. Make sure that the trigger bar articulates smoothly without any interference. And then I'm going to use a larger surface punch to drive the pin in, and it should not protrude from either side. And I can tell that the trigger bar is captured. There is actually a slot inside in our cutout in the trigger, and that's what maintains and holds the trigger bar in its position. All right, so now I've got the slave pin in, I have the trigger return spring in position on the slave pin, and I've got the slide lock bars in position. I'm going to stick that into the frame. I'm going to press on the trigger so that it rotates the back end of the trigger bar upwards. Next thing I'm going to do is put the locking block in position. Now I'm going to install the trigger pivot pin and try to get everything aligned and in position. I'm applying the pressure against the trigger pivot pin, and then it's a matter of wiggling everything to get it all aligned. And sometimes this will go easier than other times. I'm also going to want to make sure that the trigger return spring is centered in the trigger bar in that groove. If it gets pushed over to the side, it can interfere with pushing the pin through. So you heard that click. If it stalls out a little bit, you may end up having to use a small thing like a dental pick or a small needle to help pull the trigger return spring over the bar or the trigger pin. I've got most of that through. And we are in. Now I'm going to install the front roll pin. And in this case, I went a little bit too far, so I'm going to pop this back slightly. Put the takedown lever back in. And I'm just going to check and make sure that we've got relatively smooth operation. Now this trigger return spring will generate in a standard 9mm 357 and 40, 357 SIG, sorry. It'll generate a 4-pound trigger pull or thereabouts. All right, so now we're moving on to the Sear housing block. The first thing I need to do is remove the ejector, which I've already done, and push the Sear pivot pin out of position. Notice I keep my thumb over just to make sure I don't lose anything. Remove the Sear. And then I need to remove the Sear plunger and spring. And if you notice, the spring that I'm using is the larger 1/8-inch diameter Sear spring and plunger. The reason we're recommending this is that it reduces or eliminates the chance of Sear bounce or flutter. The original Sear spring that's in the guns that were made essentially prior to September of 2010 use a smaller, about an 0.070 diameter spring, which is much shorter. Springs, when you design a spring for a particular use, the amount of energy that the spring can store and return to the Sear in this case is a function of the compression length squared. And what that means is that the original spring was substantially shorter, so you're affecting the amount or the speed and rate at which the Sear spring can return the energy and push the Sear back up into position to catch the striker. Because we've got better mechanical advantage with the new Sear, we strongly encourage the use of the larger Sear spring and plunger. It's also a fact, it's also a point that we, with this new Sear and trigger, we're basically shortening the overall trigger travel, which means our reset point and striker release point are closer together. So you've got less over travel and less pre-travel. What that means in terms of Sear flutter is the closer you get those two points together, the greater chance that Sear flutter will effectively hold the Sear at a point where the trigger bar can't slip back underneath and hold it down to the point where the slide and the striker will override and bypass right across that. So now what I'm doing is I'm installing the Sear pin and the Sear, and I'm using something to hold and compress the Sear in position while I apply pressure to the Sear pivot pin. That allows me to align it up, get that pin in place. Now I can install a Sear or the ejector. In a minute, I need to get the surface for the ram lined up too. There we go. So lining those surfaces up. And again, with this one, that aluminum filler plug, you want to make sure that that's still in position. Now I should be able to install this. And now I can put the back retaining pin in position. All right, let's check some of the functioning. Right now I'm pressing on the trigger. I'm pressing on the side of the trigger rather than the safety, just to make sure that the safety function of the center lever is active. Depressing the trigger safety lever clears it out of the way and I can depress the trigger. My Sear is engaging on the Sear cam and the loop. Pinning the trigger to the rear, disconnecting, letting go, it's snapping back. Everything seems to be functioning. All right, let's put the top in and see what happens next. Now again, we've changed the timing so that there's very, very little over travel and pre-travel. Because of that, our standard USB will not work because the timing is such that the vertical leg of the trigger bar is engaging the ledge sooner. Make sure everything functions. So if you can see, total trigger distance from where it's engaging the Sear is that point, disengaging the striker block and breaking the shot. And that averages about a tenth of an inch to an eighth of an inch. So between 0.1 and 0.125 is what you can expect for overall trigger travel. Trigger pull weight should be somewhere right around 4 pounds with this setup. And with this particular gun, because it's been used quite a bit, we're right at 3 3/4 pounds. Okay, the forward sit Sear and trigger, while it was designed originally for the 9mm 357 SIG 40 calibers also will work with the 45s. In this case, we have a 45 compact and we've installed the trigger assembly and system in this gun. And as you can see, the function is the same. You still have a safety function, which is smaller in profile, that is positive. You have a solid, hard anodized aluminum trigger that should last for almost forever. And you have a trigger pull, which much shorter pre-travel and over-travel. That concludes our tutorial on how we install the Apex Tactical Forward Set Sear and Trigger. If you have any questions, please contact us at www.apextactical.com.